Welcome back. Today we shall discuss about decompression sickness, right? Decompression sickness. What is decompression sickness? Decompression sickness is a disorder which occurs in individuals who are subjected to high atmospheric pressures for a considerable period of time, and then when they are suddenly moved to a lower atmospheric pressure, right? Who are all the affected individuals? People who dive underwater, that is deep sea divers, aviators who ascend to high altitudes rapidly from the surface of the earth, and people who work in caissons. Caissons are chambers, watertight chambers, where high pressure is maintained to keep the water out. Okay, before understanding the pathophysiology of decompression sickness, we have to understand a few facts of physics. Okay, one, as we descend deep into the sea, okay, as we descend deep into the sea, the atmospheric pressure increases. How much increases? For every 10 meters, the pressure increases by 1 atmosphere, right? So this is fact number one. Number two, as the atmospheric pressure increases, a substance which is in a gaseous state can be forced into a liquid state. Right, this is number two. Right, number three, the gas which became liquid at high pressure, now this reverts back to gaseous state once the atmospheric pressure is lowered. Okay, coming to the pathophysiology of decompression sickness, whenever a diver who inhales a mixture of oxygen and nitrogen dives underwater, okay, as he dives beneath the surface of the sea, what happens? The atmospheric pressure increases, right? So to counter this increase in atmospheric pressure, we have to deliver the oxygen nitrogen mixture at high pressure. Okay, this also has to be delivered at high pressure to counter the increase in atmospheric pressure in the sea surrounding the diver's body, right? So what happens, this nitrogen gradually gets dissolved in the body tissues. Okay, now the blood has very little solubility for nitrogen, but fat has high nitrogen solubility, so large volumes of nitrogen dissolves in the body fat. So now as long as the diver stays underneath the sea, there is no problem, right? Now if the person now ascends back, okay, if that person ascends back to the surface of the sea, when he ascends slowly, there is no problem, okay. But if he ascends rapidly, okay, what happens? He is now exposed to a low atmosphere at the surface of the sea compared to high atmospheric pressure which was there when he was underneath the sea, right? So now what happens, large amount of dissolved nitrogen would revert back to gaseous state, resulting in formation of nitrogen bubbles. Okay, so these nitrogen bubbles would coalesce, that is combine with each other to form larger bubbles. Okay, smaller nitrogen bubbles would combine to form larger bubbles. Okay, so these larger bubbles would go and block the blood vessels. Okay, this blockage of blood vessels leads to ischemia of the body tissues. Okay, so whenever ischemia happens, the functional capability of the cells is lost, right? What are the symptoms and signs which occur in decompression sickness? The signs and symptoms depend upon which body part is affected. Generally, the joints are most affected by the nitrogen bubbles. Okay, so joints, we would have severe pain. Okay, so because joints are most commonly affected, this disease is also called as bends. Okay, now suppose there is blockade of blood vessels in the pulmonary vessels. Okay, pulmonary vessels, there would be shortness of breath, that is dyspnea. Okay, this we called as chokes, right? If there is blockade of blood vessels, coronary blood vessels, okay, coronary blood vessels, then we can get myocardial ischemia. Okay, if the blood vessels are blocked in the brain, central nervous system, okay, the individual can suffer from visual impairment, okay, dizziness, headache, coma, convulsions, or even death, right? So depending upon the blockade of vessels in different sites of the body, the symptoms appear in the individual. Okay, how long does it take for the decompression sickness to appear after the individual comes to the surface? Usually the decompression sickness happens within 30 minutes after the individual has reached the surface of the sea. Okay. Okay, now we can have two questions. Why should the person spend a long period of time underneath the sea for him to experience decompression sickness when he comes to the surface? That is question number one. The solubility of nitrogen in the blood is very, very poor. Okay, but the nitrogen, okay, it dissolves in lipids very easily. Okay, but these lipids, they have poor blood supply. Okay, so for the nitrogen to get dissolved in the body fats, it takes some time, a considerable amount of time to dissolve in the lipid. That is why a person has to spend a considerable amount of time underneath the surface before he can experience the decompression sickness when he comes to the surface. Okay, if he spends a very less amount of time, say only 5 minutes or 10 minutes at a depth of 10 meters, when he comes to the surface fastly, nothing happens. Okay, question number two, what happens when the diver ascends to the surface of the sea very slowly? Okay, when the person ascends to the surface slowly, the amount of nitrogen bubbles formed would be less. Okay, so this less amount of nitrogen bubbles formed would be easily exhaled into expired air. Okay, so there is no blockade of blood vessels by these nitrogen bubbles, so we don't get to experience any ischemic symptoms, right? So how would you treat it? Okay, we treat the individual who is having decompression sickness by putting him back into a recompression chamber. Okay, you put him back in a recompression chamber, increase the pressure to high levels, and then gradually you bring down the pressure in a staged manner. Okay, this is called a staging actually. So when we do so, a small amount of nitrogen bubbles are released at each decrease in the pressure within the recompression chamber, and then all the nitrogen is gradually let out of the body. Okay, and you can also give hyperbaric oxygen, to treat to split the large nitrogen bubbles into much smaller nitrogen bubbles. Okay, so for that hyperbaric oxygen therapy is useful, right?